it's time to go to that next level, man. I'm just so excited and grateful to the Most High. Alright, let's cook.
Yeah, sir. Hello there, hello world. It is Kosine. Now let me give you the whole government. Marcos Enrique Palacios, aka Kosine. And welcome to another episode of the True Serum Podcast. And this episode specifically is called Changed. We're going to get into some deep, deep shit today.
Sure.
Because, you know, this is probably the most meaningful and personal record on the True Serum album. And so it is only right that I have people that are near and dear to my heart, you know, my cousin, and then of course, this is, you know, an industry brother, not an industry brother, but a brother I met in the industry that has now become family and been like, you know, really a big brother, mentor, KP. So, you know, you know, it's really a big deal. This brother, if you're not familiar, if you live in the basement of under a rock, and you don't know about this.
Actually, I'm not a celebrity at all. So actually, it's easy not to know none of this shit. But go ahead.
People sitting there looking like, oh my God, oh my God.
What yeah, you live in the basement of under a rock if you don't know about this ATL legend, KP. Dungeon Family is in the building. This man is Grammy Award winning and also owns a 96 Impala. You know what I mean?
Do. I'm very proud of that, by the way.
Man, look, I'm just trying to really just pour water into the real nigga cup so that it's real nigga alert. You know what I'm saying?
Context clues is what they call that.
Right at that moment, somebody was watching this podcast and was doing something else, and then heard the Impala and sat up straight because they know about that fraternity.
Yeah, so buddy got an Impala and a Grammy. That's got it.
From the A, got the Impala, got the Grammy, and he in this thing, man. For real. So I appreciate you pulling up.
Hey, man, thanks for asking me to come.
Yes, sir. This and then excellent. We have a young cuzzo, Antonica Johnson.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying?
Does he speak Panamanian Tony. Also?
A little bit of Panamanian. That's tight. Spanish, a little English.
That's what's up.
You know?
Because I feel like this is how I've been able to manage and keep my mind this time by having this constant blend of industry family and
Family.
You know what I'm saying? People that knew my mama before I knew my mama. You know
Facts.
What I'm saying?
Facts.
That's tight.
And so, thank you so much, Tony, for coming all the way from good old Memphis, Tennessee, to sunny California. Yay!
I can't wait. I can't wait to tell it all. Let's go.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. You know, this is the one time you get a pass
can't
to
wait.
Talk shit about your goddamn cousin. You know, stay away from the stories as far as changing my diaper. That's a little
gonna intimate. Tell them all. I'm gonna tell them all.
Jesus Christ. but let's get into it. I want to start with you, KP, because you just had the time to watch the film that came out with my album Truth Serum. You watched the Truth Serum EP film, and so I'm just curious as to some of your initial reactions from watching the film. I mean, I don't want to give it away as far as the Demon Girls. I see
you already did. You just did that.
No.
No. I mean, I think I could talk around it. No, I mean, it was first of all, it was shot. It was great. It was shot extremely well. Like,
shout out to Noise.
What's up, Noise?
Mm-hmm. In your building.
Beautiful.
I mean it not in a like a condescending way. I mean it in like a like quality, like it. You know, it rivals some of your favorite TV shows or movies. Like it felt, it didn't feel like, yo man, I shot this movie right quick. It felt, it was casted, it was wardrobed, it was propped. Like even got a car out of it. That was crazy.
Right, right.
Like yeah, y'all should see this. Like it's Demon Girls. A girl gave him a car. That's crazy.
The like, Demon Girls.
Yeah, and these are two different sets of girls. That's crazy.
That's like real trailer. Somebody definitely is pausing this to go watch the movie. Then they're going to come back.
It's called True Serum.
And finish watching it. Yes, sir. Yeah. Tony Cuzzo, like you knowing me from young diaper stage to seeing my first EP film.
Mm-hmm.
What did you experience? What were you feeling watching your little cousin get active?
I definitely had a lot of moments of, I saw Marcos. Mm-hmm. I saw Kosine. Mm-hmm. I saw Enrique Dragon. Like, I saw little pieces. Something as simple as, you know, the way you hold your face. Mm-hmm. Or the way your body is positioned in the shot. Like, I know exactly what you're thinking. Mm-hmm. So it was pretty cool to see the artist and the cousin on screen. I loved mm-hmm. it.
What's the biggest difference between? Watch how I take this over. Uh-oh. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Uh-oh. Go ahead, so go ahead, what's the biggest difference between?
Here we go. Here we go. Kosine
and Marcos.
Kosine is a performer. Kosine does things to get particular reactions. Marcos is naturally funny. He is really, really personable, but is very natural. When he's co-signed, it's very calculated.
The shades.
All the time. Like, who take those damn sunglasses off? We in the house. Why?
We in the house.
Why?
I don't understand how I got surrounded by everybody that hates sunglasses, but
Cool in the sun.
In the sun.
9 o'clock at night.
But when I got them all indoors all the time. Yeah.
Like, unless some shits is like solar panels and you doing some work with them, I don't know.
Not one prescription in them. Need a prescription.
That's fair. That's fair. So those are the differences. And, mm-hmm. and who is Enrique mm-hmm. Dragon?
He crazy. Yeah, Enrique Dragon is the dude I had to come see in L.A. Mm. and see if I could find Marcos and bring him on back to the house.
Marcos.
Boy, have mercy.
That dude.
So, again, this is Enrique episode.
Dragon is a real strong name for another personality.
That is,
it's
that,
so accurate, though. It's so accurate.
That is pure I don't give a fuck land.
Mm. Yeah.
It's just I don't give a fuck land.
Yeah, with wings.
With Game of Thrones dragon.
Yeah, that's
wings.
All I was thinking. Oh, like,
bruh.
Oh, God.
But flying over LA. This is episode changed. And so now I'm thinking about that 2015 moment and my family. This is what it felt like, KP. It felt like I was in a baseball game and I was pitching and I was having a pretty bad game. And my family walked to the mound like the coach do.
Yeah.
With the pitchers just out there throwing the whole shit away. And they say, okay, you're done.
Yeah.
You're done. Hand me the ball. Yeah. Hey, have a seat. We got it. And that's really what my family did. And I moved back to Chicago. All my stuff is in storage. I had what I thought was the bachelor pad of the year. Like, I'd never seen a more player spot. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's always like that in your head.
I had an 80 inch. I had an 80 inch. Like, I had a really big room. You know, it ain't no square feet in LA. So my eyes was hurting because of how close I was to this big ass TV in this
room. But it was 80.
You know what I'm saying? But it was 80, though. It was like Coming to America, just something ridiculous in the living room.
Yeah, I'm sorry. The sauna.
But everything had to go in storage, and I had to go back to Chicago. And again, it was really one of the best things that ever happened to me because it was the much needed LA detox
mm-hmm.
That saved my life. You know what I mean? And a lot of people really don't know about this moment. They don't know about the LA detox moment. And it's kind of wild. You know,
yeah, everybody who moved to LA and stayed a little bit knows about it, though.
Mm.
And knows about it. Please speak on what the city can do to you if you're not all the way grounded.
Well, if you're not all the way grounded, you come to L.A., it's a city full of, you know, like, mainly actors.
Mm.
Like, people come here to be something else.
Mm.
So if you don't know who you are already, it's like you can fall into, oh, that's what we're doing.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
Big facts. Big facts. Tony and Yo, in your short stint of coming back to L.A., because you haven't been here as long as us, so I feel like you can probably see it a lot clearer, you know, being that you just kind of tap in and see it and get out.
Mm-hmm.
What's your take on the L.A. or the Hollywood scene, I should say?
It's just a lot of pretending. A lot of pretending and a lot of enabling. A lot of people, like he said, wanting to be something else, and a lot of people around them hyping it up. Like saying, yeah, you could be that if you want to be, or no, you're not who you really are, or... it's a lot of fake and phony. And I can see how it's not hard at all to get caught up in it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So my question to you is, and I really don't want to know the answer to this question.
Can't wait.
I'm just about to walk into the shit. fuck. When did you know?
I'm sorry.
That your cousin needed a timeout. Like when, and I'm, you know, I feel like everybody, my sister, you got two, you got all these different characters mm-hmm. that were around, but specifically 2014 and 2015. Mm-hmm. Cause I do feel like you were on the campaign of Marcos, go your ass home. Mm-hmm. I feel like you were on that team. I know until Linda flew out. For like,
how you think she got here?
Okay. So you started the team as far as.
So this is my version of events. Names will be changed to protect the innocent. No. So two called me and said, you need to come take a look at your boy. He out here, he's wilding. This is not my brother. And he had never called me and said anything like that. You know, y'all have your little tiffs and your fights, and I might get a call from one side or the other. And so I called you, like, yo, what's going on? And talking to you on the phone, I said, what the hell is going on? Like, it was just real erratic. It was very disorganized, just, you know, a whole lot of
ad-libs.
Man, it was crazy.
Yeah, shit.
I mean, just.
What?
It was so bad that I hung up the phone and booked the flight. I said, I need to go look at him. Because I hadn't seen you in a couple years either. We had been talking on the phone, but I hadn't seen you. And I said, this seems bad. Let me go look at it. And you picked me up from the airport. And when I looked into your eyes, I was like, oh, shit, it's bad. It's bad. This boy is crazy. And we got back to your place from the airport, and we walked in the door. It was just random people in your house. And I was like, hey, who's that? You like, I don't know. Walk up another flight of stairs. Hey, who is that? Do these people stay here? I think that's Matt, who is this? I don't know. Come on. Walked up another flight of stairs. Because it had like, what, 3-4 levels. We got to the roof, and there's some more people sitting on the roof. And you're like, yeah, this is the guy I wanted to introduce you to. And you couldn't remember his name.
Shit.
And so we had this whole like 15-minute conversation with this dude who you don't know his name, but you're very excited for me to meet him.
Gone.
Shit. And I was like, okay, that's it, buddy. So I walked back down the flights of stairs and cleaned house. I was like, hey, you gotta go. Get out of here. I don't know who you are, leave.
Hey, man, I wish you? Y'all leave. Had production to make the cartoon that's happening man. In my head to the story.
It was just like that. It was just oh, like God. That.
It's like a tornado going downstairs.
I mean, like, it was crazy. Some dude told me he lived there. I was like, I don't care. Get out. I don't know you. Get out. And
Show me a bill.
I didn't even ask. Right. Get out. I don't know you. Bye.
Right.
I knew certain people by name. They got to stay. Matt got to stay.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I was like, yo, this is bad. So then we just spent some time together for like 2 days. And I was like, maybe he detoxed a little bit. He just gone right now. He just need a little minute. So on day two, I said, I'm going to call all my aunties because he need to go his ass back to Chicago today. And they got on a flight. They were out there on day 3 of my visit. We packed it up on days 4 and 5.
I was so mad.
So mad.
That Auntie Linda came to my doorstep without calling first.
What?
I'm like, who even told you? How do you even... And I think it might have even been just some embarrassment too. Like, so I need to go home. You know what I'm saying? It's crazy. Sheesh.
Yeah, it was a time.
Is that like getting your name called at the skating rink? Like, your mom and them here?
Ooh.
Yo, it was so bad.
Kosine, your mom and them here.
It literally was that.
Your ride here, Kosine.
But you don't want to go home.
They turn the music off too.
Right.
No, cosine. Yeah. No, it's your mom and your aunt. No.
Nigga.
Hey, excuse me, y'all. I'm sorry. This nigga won't get off the floor. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So yeah, it definitely was the moment of embarrassment, and it's crazy because when I got back to Chicago. I remember going to my auntie house, walking in the backyard, and just crying. But like the sob cry, because I knew I fucked up. You know,
you know you fucked up, right?
Mm. Yeah.
Like, I knew as I was walking around the grass, like, this shit might be over, and it's all my fault. You know what I'm saying? And it was just one of them hard-ass, ugly cries. And it was a moment where I knew my mama wasn't proud. You know how sometimes you wonder, like, man, I wonder if she's proud. I didn't have to wonder.
What can she, almost like, she can say something to make this look cool.
It was nothing, Katie.
Yeah, my baby's just, you know, he just enjoying himself a little bit.
It was past all of that, man. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And yeah, it's crazy because even to this day, like, looking at old interviews, certain, like, old speeches, can't.
The litness of it? Or, ooh, like, what was it? Like, what about it?
It's like, I damn near was James Brown a little bit. Like, I'm looking at it, and not like, and like, in a good, but then, like, James Brown, when James Brown was...
Like, the Ted Turner. The,
ooh.
Well, yeah, Ted.
Yeah.
Hurts to watch a little.
It was that.
Yeah.
It was
so
that.
But there has to be like a point in that, right? So what was, how long were you back in Chicago before you realized?
It was like a nine month period. And it's crazy because like it, and I don't mean any disrespect to anybody that has actually been in like real war and overseas, and you know, it serves in, you know, the military, but it felt like I came home from spiritual warfare. I felt like I had just escaped. You know what I'm saying? I damn near had PTSD and was like, I wasn't sleeping a lot. That was really like the main thing. Like I had anxiety, you know what I'm saying? And I was not sleeping. I did not sleep. And so being at home in my aunt's house, you know, 2-3 o'clock in the morning, you know, my cousin is kind of just hearing me moving around. My cousin Laka, shout out to my cousin Laka.
Hey Laka.
And I want to say her guy was like, maybe taking a psychology class, or she might have been taking a psychology class or something, but she definitely was my therapist when I came home, and she'd just cook for me late at night, sit at the table and be like, what did they do to you, baby? Like, just tell me, you know what I'm saying? It was just like, you know what I'm saying? You understand? It's like, I was sometimes doing my best that little late night, goddamn, the ugly.
Yeah.
And you know, and I probably should have did more of that when I lost my mom in 2003.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
But, you know, that young responsibility, you know what I'm saying?
Soldier on thought process.
Mm-hmm.
It's like I'm in college. All my friends are living life, right? These are some of the brokest times of life, but some of the funnest. I know that ain't a word, but funnest times of life.
You learned it in college.
Bruh, you know what I'm saying? And I'm sitting here with a full inheritance and a broken heart. And at the cemetery, not able to shake it, like not able to shake it. Then even coming out here, what a lot of people, you know, don't know about is our artist, my first artist, Aaron Michael Cox, passed away at 22 years old of testicular cancer.
Mm-hmm.
22. We just about to sign him to Columbia Records right after Adele. They're like, oh, this is our male Adele. Oh, this is great. You know what I mean? And got him as Pub Dylan Universal. We were in London working on Rihanna. Working on Rihanna album, and got the call 2 weeks later, kid's gone. And he passed away in the Sherman Oaks Hospital, literally a couple blocks from the studio. Mm-hmm. And right after that, my brother had a double lung transplant. So it's like, I gotta be finna die next. You know what I'm saying? Like, my mama, my artist slash, you know, best friend, my brother, you know, from another mother that I grew up, of course I'm gonna die next.
It's a lot.
You know what I mean? And so this like anxiety and this urgency that I gotta put out a platinum song right away because I'm finna die soon. And people are like, all of the scenarios in my mind just had me somewhere else.
Mm.
You know what I mean? And that time out of just being around family that was like, well, we don't even care about your music career, actually.
Mm-hmm.
We just happy to have you at the house. Was just like, sheesh. It felt like it was like, ooh.
You know, the funny shit is, like, I think what I thought was rock bottom, kind of, for me, was when I used to work at Sony Records, at Sony Music. I was EVP of, like, urban music, and I was, like, on, right?
Mm-hmm.
Financially, all the things that you think you want when you get in the music business to get a job and all this shit, right?
Mama, I made it.
Yeah.
Mama, I made
1,000%. And, but then I realized, the farther you get up, the farther you get away. from things that you can get away from the ground. Mm-hmm. So you start realizing, so I got fired, right? And like about 70% of the people I knew and thought I was cool with evaporated, like on some real Thanos. They were gone.
And evaporate.
Yeah,
it was the word. Bro.
Yeah, and I was just like, oh shit. And at first I was like, man, am I whack now? And I remember that moment
you
of
talking through all my feelings right now.
Like, oh man, I'm about to be whack. I ain't never gonna be able to come back because like, but literally, my son said, he's like, well, Dad, I'm glad you're here. And I was like, oh shit. And it started the spiral of thought process into, oh shit, I actually have time back. Because all the time I was spending like, yeah, what's up? The random conversations, the random travel time, the places you didn't want to go and want to be, the amount of time you give away.
Right.
Like that time got put back in.
The son was like, shit, we get to hang out.
Yeah, like, I fuck with this.
Right.
Yeah, and it made my crew stronger. Like my actual kid, my kids, like my crew got really strong. And I realized how much there was a moment where I realized, okay, a lot of the things I thought I wanted, you don't need. They're just things that people said are cool to have, but don't really apply to you. They're not applicable to your life and what you think you want. I mean, what you actually want and your purpose.
That's so heavy. I literally, it's crazy because that time in Sunday service, man, I never forget the day we was writing this song and then Ye came up to me and was like, man, when the last time somebody ever just called you and said, we have everything we need? Hey, fam, hey.
Hey, we got it. You good?
And I was like, damn. You know what I'm saying? I don't think ever in life, at least today, listening, like, and that's really to the point of what you're saying as far as, like, damn, yo, like, we really, like, I felt like a hoarder, especially, like, not even getting the opportunity to pack up my apartment. It was so bad that they was like, oh, no, we already hired movers and they're going to pack. Yo, you just need to.
Yeah. You just carry your ass.
Carry your ass. You know what I'm saying?
You ain't even got to put clothes in the bag. Yeah. We got you.
And I remember, like, even, like, my wardrobe when I got home was so weak because I ain't really get a chance.
Yeah, you done put the thing together.
I ain't really get a chance to get the basics aligned. So I'm sitting here going out looking like, oh, man.
Oh, you doing the high-low thing. Oh, wow. That's tight.
And it's so much growth in these moments, man. There's so much growth in these moments. So, Tony. You done got on this plane. You done came all the way out. We have our debut album out. Woo-hoo. We got our EP film out. We have a show that we can't say the network that's coming out later this year that people don't know about, and a movie that we can't talk about.
It's a lot going on.
So much secretive shit.
Man, I done made that mistake. One of the best. Man, I wonder if she'd be mad. I'm not going to say her name. But I'm thinking about one of the most legendary industry cuss outs that I got for talking about birthday cake before it came out.
I wonder who it's about.
I mean, we cool to this day. I don't think she'd be mad. Saying, like,
let's not. Let's just not. Let's just not.
It's a Def Jam A&R.
What?
That.
Too late.
Saw, and look, I ain't even say nothing on the carpet, but I still was just in the ballpark of it.
The popping was like, it was like vague popping.
Fam, because how can you not? How can you hold? I remember being in.
How can you hold?
How can you hold this? It's Greystone. I'm gonna give you the whole scene. It's Greystone. We in L.A. I see my dog Chris Anacute. Shout out Chris Anacute. And I hear on the mic, shout out to Rihanna in the building. Riri in this thing. Greystone, what's up, L.A.? And I said, oh my gosh, she's here. Birthday cake is going nuts right now, and I have never met her. I say, Chris. Rihanna's
it.
Here, please. Oh, you ain't never met her? Follow me.
Uh-oh.
I said, whoa.
Man, I wish I could produce this shit out of my head. But go ahead.
I follow Chris. Go to the VIP section. He says, yo, Rihanna, come here. I got Kosine here for you to meet. She hops up a little fast, bro, and scurries. She says, wait. The interns? I've been dying to meet you. I said, oh my God, I could die in your arms.
Yeah, this
tonight.
Shit got, you got backlit. She like, got backlit. It bruh. Was like.
And so.
It's a moment.
I lean in for the hug. and I hear the flashes, so I instantly just picture myself on media takeout the next day as her new boyfriend.
Which is fine.
Oh, my God.
At this moment, I'm saying, this is perfect. Let me hold on and really make sure she... So that this camera flash, please, please, media takeout. This is it. This is it. I'm her new boyfriend. And
although I'm not, the heat that's going to come from this is going to make me somebody's new boyfriend.
This is all I needed was to be hugging on Rihanna and Greystone, man. Then she says, I want to put out the remix to Birthday Cake. And don't tell anyone, but I think I'm going to put Chris Brown on it.
And you like,
could not wait.
That's it. I just went home and started packing up shit. I just started putting shit in boxes.
I need more room because this shit is not going to look good with my Chris Brown ass, remix ass, Rihanna birthday cake.
Clearly, I need more square feet. And that's another reason why I went left, KP. As soon as I heard that, I just started thinking about shit to buy and move.
Yeah.
Instantly. Yeah.
Ridiculous.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Hey.
This is ridiculous.
As I'm taking myself back to that, I'm like, I really went home and just started packing up shit. Like, that's it.
Man, kind of nigga have this kind of shit around the house when you got a fucking remix with.
About to go to the moon tomorrow.
Bitch, I can't even. I'm sorry.
Oh, my God. Right. Right.
Right.
I definitely changed my phone number. Changed my number right away. That's it. You niggas can't just call me anytime. You know what I'm saying? I got to think.
I got to need a birthday cake remix number. what are you talking about?
Oh man, so but yeah,
that's like BBC before birthday cake.
Wait, what are you talking about? You talking about
Kosine BBC?
BBC?
Oh, okay,
because you know what it is. Thinking about goals, right? What were my goals early on? I wanted the song in the club that they played when the actual closer DJ got up at about 1 o'clock in the morning and they started bringing the bottles out. I wanted my song at that time.
That's why it sound like,
there you go.
Bruh.
It sound like the candles and the sparklers.
That's literally
what birthday cake sound like to me in my head.
Man, ass and birthday cake are the same tempo.
I know.
So by that year, DJs was going back to back and it was like I owned a good 9 minutes in the club
at prime time, peak hour, like peak time though,
where I just tried to act like I wasn't even noticing that my song was on. It was just like wait, which y'all, so we all finna go after this? Oh wait, they playing that? No. Oh, y'all crazy.
This is terrible.
Man, chill out.
Knowing damn well I probably been ready to go, but it's like you can't even lead a club and
we still top 10.
Miss your 9 minutes.
Mm-mm. Yeah, we still top 10 with one of these songs. They're gonna play something.
Shit.
I'm not going until they do that.
Shit. That was my goal, KP.
That's fine. I mean, listen, hey, no judgment here. Like, I get it 1,000%. I like doing things good enough for people to play them on their own so that I can not have to trip on the fact that they playing them. Like, oh, it's real life.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So you
know, that's a goal.
You know the feeling, bro.
Absolutely.
You know the feeling.
Yeah.
So switching gears, and as we start to kind of wind this one down, for me, one thing that I appreciate about you, KP specifically, and something that I really respect is really your temperament. You know what I'm saying? Like me being, I think my cousin used the word erratic, you know what I'm saying, and all over the place sometimes.
Several
times. That's a T.I. word.
My question to you is from like a mental health standpoint, you know what I'm saying? A sanity standpoint. How do you keep it together, brother? How, man? What's the regimen? Is it a routine? What is it that... And you can be like, host, you know what? You don't know shit about my life. I don't always have
when I
see you, bro, like, and even your advice.
I feel like there's never a point, like, no matter how bad some shit is happening in my world, I know people who shit is worse. Mm. So I just eat that one. Like, it's almost like, all right, let me figure out what I got to do to get past it.
Mm. But
the perspective of it and the perspective of relativity, I guess. Mm-hmm. It's like, like, I'm in a really cool place in my world, in my friend group, in, like, my family. I'm like, the probably the most famous person in my family, but the only non-famous person in my friends, which is weird
because
none of them are famous. It's
That's
just like
balance.
It just means that I'm more famous than my aunt,
right?
You know what I'm saying? But
right.
Because I hang with famous people,
right?
Like, not hang, but you know what I'm saying? Like, I associate, I work with, and it's like, it's the reality that I'm like, yeah, I'm cool, I appreciate it, but this nigga got 45 Grammys. Like, my homeboy got like 30 Grammys.
Right.
You know what I'm
right.
saying? And it's like, so my one is just an accomplishment that says that I've done the work to be here.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm cool with that, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not tripping because I know that there are people who can do something better.
Mm-hmm.
And the only thing I have, well, not the only thing, but I feel like the temperament comes from just being real with myself and understanding that it's not that big a deal.
Right, right.
Like, because I've been up enough to mm-hmm. feel like, you know, or to see, I've been up enough to do some dumb shit while up,
mm-hmm.
but realize it wasn't that far down
mm.
from that.
Mm.
So it's like, it's always a tread water kind of thing for me, no matter how much success is happening.
Mm.
Like, I keep it in that feeling, so that way I don't have to, I just don't ever want to fall off. So I just don't right. want to, I don't even trip.
Because mm-hmm.
I'm like, I feel like the, that's when it happens. Like, mm-hmm. I never want to be hot.
Right, right. Mm.
Like, I think that's what it is.
I feel like Swiss gave me that bar. He said two things. One, of course, he talked about traveling, but he was like, look, it ain't even about, you know, being number one for me. I'm cool with being in the top 10 for 20 years.
Yeah. I like the idea of consistency. I think I think that part is what makes it not get old to me, because I feel like you can, like, burning out is because you got hot.
Mm.
Like, so I just mm-hmm. don't need to be that. I don't want to be cold.
Right, right.
Like, I like tropical. I
like nice little, you know, like, nice little simmer. You know what I'm saying?
72, 73. Like, I can do that
a
shit
good,
forever.
Comfortable. I love
and
that.
And isn't it a doper accomplishment, really, to be able to do it for a long period of time?
I don't know yet. Like, I don't know if it's doper. I just know that it suits me. Hmm. Like, you know, because, like, I'll get in a situation where someone will be like, oh, okay, B, I know you. You did da-da-da. And then mm-hmm. I'll walk 10 steps and someone not know shit.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it's like, that's right. real life.
You just start feeling good.
Yeah,
and then,
like,
boom,
like,
nice little humble.
You were that nigga for a total of 8 minutes. like, 20-foot walk.
I gotta give you this, KP. All the times where I couldn't get in the club and my hits was playing in the background, literally playing on the back of the bouncer head. And I'm like, sir, I'm really, you know what I'm saying? Like, they playing me right. Who are you, sir? And it's just like,
oh, you know what? I know exactly what happened. I saw somebody say, you don't know who I, you must not know who I am at an early age.
That'll fix it, won't it?
Yeah, I was like, they don't. They have no clue what you're talking about. Like, and
you must
and
not whatever. Know who I am.
No.
At all.
Not at all.
Nah, it does. It's not applicable to that person's life. Like, it doesn't come up. Like, you never come up. And I just don't. I ain't never want to be that person to expect you to just
right.
know me out of all the billions of people of on the earth. So it's just like, you know, I find I'm grateful. And I'm appreciative that mm-hmm. I get to occupy the space that I get and mm-hmm. consistently under my terms.
Mm. And Tony, how mm-hmm. you keep it together all these years, cuzzo? Because you still are a soundboard for me, you know what I'm saying? In my whirlwind of madness, what are your tips for peace, serenity in life?
I think two things. Be good at what you're good at. You don't have to be great at everything, right? Just be good at what you're good at. Mm. And then you can feel really confident in, I can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
I can't do this, but I know
mm-hmm.
I can do this.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the second thing is surround yourself with people who want to see you win. Like, and really give people permission to hold you accountable. I think throughout the space of my life, the people that I've surrounded myself with have always pushed me, have always been able to pull my coattails and be like, yo, mm-hmm. you're not that dope, friend, because you said you wanted to do X, Y, Z. You still ain't done that. So why don't you just have a little sit down?
Mm-hmm.
So I try to be that for you.
Mm-hmm.
I try to be the person who will always tell you the truth. Even when you don't want to hear it sometimes. I just want to put this in your ear, friend.
Yeah.
Let me just say.
And the thing is, what and you tell me if I'm tripping, but when there are people who are as gifted as you, and I feel like a lot of us like are highly sensitive in a way. Mm. So I think if you plant some shit, if you throw it out there, it gets seen or caught. It's just like at the time that you want to recognize it, you'll be like, "Oh, that was for me." That, like, but you have to have people around you who you trust to.
Man, my sister, one time she walked up to me and gave me a book that said "The Wisdom of Listening." It might even be, might even brought that out somewhere. But my sister, she gave me that book, and the title alone, was like the nicest, most humble way of her saying, shut the fuck up. You know?
Just sometimes.
Shut the fuck up. And I was just like,
hey, this is a bestseller.
Damn. And like, I felt so crazy in the moment, just like.
But that's all it takes sometimes. It's like.
The wisdom of listening. Man. So, on that note, I want to thank you guys for sharing. Thank you for flying across the country, cuzzo.
Well, I didn't tell one diaper changing story, though. We done?
You want to talk about diaper changing stories?
Yeah, so, hey.
I'm going to head out.
I'll give you time for one wild story.
I got a good one. Shit. The time that, so when Coase was little, he used to love to pretend to be Michael Jackson. Our aunt and his mother are seamstresses.
Shit.
So he would always go cut strings and threads and lay them on his forehead right here.
Nigga, for little curls?
For the curls. Because Mike had precise curls.
I know the three curls.
They gave me some for the curls.
Because everybody knows. So on this particular day, he's giving concerts in the living room on a regular. Right. But on this particular day, he decided, no, what I need to do is I need to go outside because the space is bigger. I could project fully without nobody cussing me out and making all this noise in the house. He goes outside to give his concert. Comes back in 60 seconds later like, wait, I need a cape. He grabs...
Man, you and James Brown and Michael Jackson?
He grabs a bath towel to go outside to continue this concert. So around this time, me and all my other cousins are like, what is this fool doing? So we go to look out the window to watch this fool perform in the backyard. I mean, he is giving it. He is giving a show. Like, if you didn't have tickets, I hate it for you. You missed the time.
It's close to midnight.
Ooh. Then he decides, you know what I'm going to do? This is how I'm going to kill it. Close the show. I'm going to jump rope with this towel. In the backyard.
How long was this towel?
Listen, it's a bath towel.
Yeah, okay.
He's crazy.
Okay.
This Negro starts jumping rope with the towel, falls smack, dab, dead on his forehead, on the concrete.
Sound about right.
Goose head starts to pop up.
It so was now Camilla then.
We all looking through the window like, shit, we go get our ass whooped because this fool. We tried all sorts of remedies before our auntie and mama got home. He still had a goose egg. We all got beat because of Michael Jackson over here.
Shit.
Man, that is awesome because the funniest part is when you see a towel, I'm thinking, how tall was this nigga then? And how long was this towel?
Because he had to be good.
He
could
have did this, executed it properly
he
without falling.
He had to be 5 or 6. Old enough to know better. Old enough to know better.
Okay, so this is L.A., and I always hate when people do this, but at the same time, this is a fact, right? So in the irony, it's like, so when I was like 4th, 5th grade, this is like prime Michael Jackson time for me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I used to charge people to come on my balcony in my apartments to come watch me do Michael Jackson shows. I swear to God, my mama like came home. 1,000%. I also used to charge people to play my ColecoVision. But because I just knew that there was something to this shit. Like,
fam, you was hey, so I feel 10 times better because I'm sitting there like the string shit, man, I'm ashamed, fam, because
okay. So I'm okay, to match I see your strings
and I raise you.
My mama's gold headband that I put in a members only jacket, snap that bitch down like the colonel shit that nigga used to wear.
Oh my God.
Yeah, straight up.
Yeah. Yeah. Mike will do that to you though.
Hey, Mike, man, let me tell you something, man. Moonwalker, all them shits, man. Oh, you couldn't tell me. So much so where the point where, like, I didn't listen to Prince until I was 30.
Like, you were banging on Prince because of Mike.
Because, like, what? Chicago White Sox and the Cubs. You know what
yeah,
I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, like, I associated Prince with my Auntie Marche, and I just felt like that was grown. Like, my Auntie Marche was like,
she was
that's grown.
Shit.
What?
You know what I'm saying? But then when I saw, the first time I saw Purple Rain is the same day I made Anaconda. So by then, the Prince, whenever I would tap into and yes, go on a Prince case study, oh my God, man.
So Anaconda came out in what year?
That was the first time I seen Purple. I had listened to Prince before.
Okay, but I'm just asking.
That was the first, 2014. That was the first time I seen the movie. And it was crazy because I was.
So that's actually that was kind of like the highlight of your low point.
100%.
Absolutely.
Wow.
I literally had one of my homies that was just like, I'm going to just come pull up on you. And he bring that up like, man, remember that time when you like really was doing the Prince case study? Because it's like I wasn't sleeping. And I'm just sitting there like, yo, how was Prince like, and just studying the change, chord changes.
Oh, no, he's brilliant.
Everything, because I was executive producer.
Like, there's a song, Forever. Forever in my life. Mm. There's a song he has where he takes the backgrounds and they come a bar before the actual part of the lead, where them shits just drop and you find yourself singing backgrounds early and it's like this, wow,
right?
Like, what were you on? Like, who were you impressing that day? Like, because that's what I think. I'm like, somebody, you were trying to flex on somebody that day. Like, you know what I'm gonna do?
Right.
Watch this. Hey, I'm only listening to this. I'm just trying something.
And I think that's the thing about it. I never understood. I wasn't sleeping. I was listening. And I never got it. It was just like, Prince, you're unfigureoutable, nigga. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And then, man, it's crazy. That Purple Rain day. I remember clearing out the house, rolling up a bunch of weed, and being like, what? And it made me think about Quincy Jones' autobiography.
Yes. That's
because it's like music saved you. Mm-hmm. Like,
straight up.
Mm-hmm.
You screaming in the pillow,
mm-hmm,
was you playing the guitar. And so... If you don't even have that trauma, if you're not living what that man's life was,
you can't do that.
You can't like, do.
Listen, man, think about what struggle makes you like. Struggle. The understanding of real struggle will inspire you to do amazing shit.
Absolutely.
Now, I don't mean it to say that we all should be struggling to make great shit.
Right.
But I'm just saying that it's not a mystery that some of the more talented people in the world have a different kind of trauma. Which I think is that whole X-Men kind of thing, where like something happened, like you walked into it, you got bit by a radioactive spider, like some fucked up shit happened,
right?
That gave you another sense that you weren't necessarily thinking about. Like, that's that.
It's crazy because as I'm hearing you say that, I feel like you talking about Black people just in general, right?
Yeah.
The trauma, the struggle that
like
we have endured.
We look, think about this. It's like when you think about like movies like Any Given Sunday, where it's like he can look at the field and people disappear, right?
Right.
Because he knows he needs to get to the goal. So it's like anything in the way ain't there no more. Because in order for me to get my mom out the hood, to get this happen, I got to get there.
Yep.
So none of this shit matters.
Mm-hmm.
And it's never in vain.
And it's not
the struggle is never in vain.
Yeah.
There's always going to be something in it for you, specifically.
Yeah, for you,
for
exactly.
You.
Yeah. To me, that's the most like uplifting, looking back on these low times and thinking about change, how much I grew, how much I needed that. And even in my scripture reading, it's a Psalms, I want to say it's Psalms 119, where it says, thank you for your affliction, that I might learn your statutes. Like, thank you for this moment.
Yeah.
So I can really sit back and get closer to you. You know what I mean? Not to be on my heavy spiritual bag, but those were the moments, you know what I mean, for me where I just really, really grew, you know?
Yeah, like, so. I think, like, and it's since speaking into mental health trauma and all that stuff, right? So as a kid, I used to go to all, I used to randomly stay at all my cousin's house all the time. Like, just my mom was young, we'd just be over somebody's house. We just be there, right? And but what it did was it had me in every part of Atlanta. Like, I'm talking about whether it was Decatur, whether it was College Park, whether it was downtown. Like, I was, I've been in every, as a child, I knew Atlanta. That was kind of the thing that also helped me later in life in music and understanding how to deal with people from different places. Like, that, that thing that irritated me so much then is the thing that makes me, why I'm comfortable where I go now.
It's a cheat code.
Yeah, it's like, like, I gotta be comfortable.
I love it. I love it. All right. Thank you guys so much. Sincerely, you know, putting out my, my debut project and
True Serum.
True Serum.
Streaming on all platforms.
Streaming on all platforms. You know, it up. Having family in the building, you know what I mean? It just really means a lot. Thank you so much for your insight. And for those that are tapped in, you know, if you, if, if you feel like there's nobody that you can talk to, I want to share with you the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, 800-273-8255. I'm going to say that one more time, 800-273-8255. We are navigating a lot during this time, you know, and so for those, again, that do have family members, you know, if you, if you're against counseling at the moment, talk to somebody. Don't feel like you have to carry all the weight of life on you. You know, change does happen. There, there is a such thing as seasons in life, and seasons change. So stay encouraged. Make sure you stream that True Serum. Again, shout out to KP and Tony for being in the building.
And shout out to Shanti Dawes with Silence of Shame.
Yeah.
You know, speaking on mental health and, you know, if, you know, like, someone who came up in our industry and dealt with the things that, that we've all dealt with. If you want to, you know, if you're in the creative space and you're looking to get more information, follow Silence of Shame, at Silence of Shame on IG, and all the other information is there. But yeah, I just want to throw that out there.
There it is. Shanti Das. Keep putting in that work. This has been the Truth Serum Podcast. I am Kosine. I'm signing out. See y'all in a minute.